Well, good morning, church. It is good to be in the house of the Lord this morning, and I'm glad to be here with you, although some of you have asked. Aaron has not started his sabbatical yet. He doesn't start that until September, but he's a little under the weather this morning, and so I got the call this morning to come and to fill in, so I appreciate your graciousness, because I've had about 2 hours with this text, so we're going to do our best to work through it together. But I'd ask you to just be praying for Aaron. As you guys know, since the beginning of this year, he's had a number of different tests, a number of different procedures, and really everybody he goes and sees, you know, it doesn't matter what type of specialist they are, says that there is no issue. And while it's a good thing to know that there's no issue with this and no issue with that, it doesn't help him to know what the issue is. And so would you just be praying that God would put in place the physician or specialist that could tell him what is going on with his health and get him to a place of better health, and that, you know, that Lord willing, he would use this sabbatical to continue to heal him of the things that are difficult for him. And so we do appreciate your prayers this morning. We're continuing on in the study in the book of John. We're going to be in the second chapter. So last week, if you guys remember, if you were here, we talked about the wedding, right, where Jesus turns water into wine, and where all these wonderful things happen. I so appreciate the way that Aaron pointed to the wine just being this representation of the joy that is in this wedding feast, and how it had run out. And yet Jesus was the one that was able to restore the joy back to this wedding. And then this conversation, right, that happens with the head steward. When the servant takes the wine, the water turned into wine to him, and he tastes it. And he goes to the bridegroom and he says, "Surely you've saved the best for last. People don't do this, but you've saved the best wine for last." And I just want to remind you, I want to tell you, I want us to think about it again, because this is the Savior that we have. This is the God that we serve. He saves the best things for last. It's so different than this world that promises the best things up front and only brings punishment and pain and death and despair. And yet we have a God who doesn't put the sweetest things up front, but as we labor, as we press in, life gets sweeter. Joy gets stronger. Ultimately, we have salvation and we have heaven one day where that joy will be complete, and he truly does save the best things for last. And I mentioned that I look back at last week's passage because John puts these things right next to each other in his writing. And we go from this picture of this wedding feast where Jesus has turned water into wine and restored the joy and reminded us of the goodness of the Father, and he's gentle and humble in the way that he does these things because that is his character. And then we go to the passage that you guys are, I'm sure, all too familiar with, where we're going to study today, where he fashions this whip and he drives the money changers out of the temple. And I want you guys to see at the outset, this is not two different Jesuses. This is one person in Christ. And I think sometimes we're quick to lean towards characteristics that we appreciate, and we're quick to ignore the others. And so we fashion for ourselves an idol, a savior that's palatable for us. Amen. He's either altogether hard and righteous and intolerant of idolatry, or he's merciful and meek and loves everybody. And yet in doing that, we've made for ourselves an idol. We've made him into something that He's not by making him only one of those things, and yet he is the picture of the invisible God, and he is both. He is altogether love, and he is also justice and righteousness. And that's what we get to see this morning. As we look at this story, that's the picture that we get right next to the wedding feast. Is Jesus indignant over what's happening in the temple? So would you turn with me to John chapter 2? We're going to look at 13 through the end of the chapter this morning. In verse 13, it says, "The Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found those who were selling oxen and sheep and pigeons and money changers sitting there and making a whip of cords. He drove them all out of the temple with the sheep and the oxen. He poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables and told those who sold the pigeons, 'Take these things away. Do not make my father's house a house of trade.' His disciples remembered that it was written, 'Zeal for your house will consume me.' So the Jews said to him, 'What sign do you show us for doing these things?' Jesus answered them, 'Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up.' And the Jews then said, 'It has taken 46 years to build this temple. Will you raise it up in 3 days?' But he was speaking of the temple of his body. When therefore he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. Now when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover feast, many believed in his name when they saw the signs that he was doing. But Jesus, on his part, did not trust himself to them because he knew all people and needed no one to bear witness about man, for he himself knew what was in man." Would you pray with me? God, we thank you this morning just for the chance to read your word. For the fact that you would reveal to us who you are, Lord. That you wouldn't keep it a secret, but you would want to show your character, Lord, and that you've preserved this word to this day that we might be able to read it. God, would you open our eyes and help us to see clearly and hear clearly from you, Lord. Would you be with me this morning as I preach, Lord? Help it to not be my words, but to be your words, Lord, and for it to speak to your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Just a few things that I want you guys to see this morning as we look at this text. We're going to start with our first point, which is really just the first verse that we read. Verse 13, it says, "The Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem." You see, Christ worshiped with God's people. I mean, as all the time that we've been studying in John, we've been looking at all of the things that have happened, and we've been seeing Christ as the fulfillment of prophecy. We saw a number of weeks back, right, where John the Baptist said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." And we pointed to the fact that this was related to a number of things that happened in the Old Testament, both God's provision of the ram and the sacrifice of Isaac, and also in the Passover, right? We saw those both of those pictures of the lamb. And then John says, "Behold, the Lamb of God." And now the Passover feast is at hand, the thing that was meant to point to Jesus, and yet he goes to worship with his people. He goes to worship with God's people for this feast that is ultimately pointing to God's salvation in him. So the first thing I want you to see is Christ worshiped with God's people. We've already talked about a number of times that they've been awaiting God's messenger, right? We talked about that as we moved from Malachi into John. We talked about this prophesied Messiah that would come, and over the last several weeks, that's been another main topic in our messages, is all of the prophecies that are pointing to Christ and the anxiousness. As we think about the ministry of John the Baptist, as we think about the beginning of Jesus' ministry, that there starts to be this anxiousness among God's people that maybe this is the thing that God has been telling us about. He hasn't said anything for 400 years, but maybe we're starting to see what God is going to do. And so they were waiting for God's messenger, even as they come into this Passover feast. And I want you to know that this is not an easy thing to enter into. I think in this one verse, in this one sentence, is a lot for us to understand. Because by all estimates, there were something like 2.5 million people that were coming into the city of Jerusalem for the Passover. So when it tells us that Jesus went up into Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover, we need to recognize that he was walking a road with millions of other people coming into Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover. And not only that, they'd been preparing for the Passover. Some of the families bringing animals with them to sacrifice. So along this road, it's not only people, it's not only families. It's likely herds of animals wandering around if they could afford to bring a sacrifice or if they had the ability to bring a sacrifice. And so as these people are starting to head into Jerusalem on this journey, I'm sure that they're talking amongst themselves. I'm sure that there's conversation to the left and to the right about, have you heard about what this John the Baptist is doing? Baptizing people for repentance down by the river. And have you heard of all the people that are coming to him? Could this be something that God is doing in our time? So they were waiting for God's messenger. And they were cleansing and preparing for the Passover. Part of the Passover feast that's instilled in Exodus chapter 12 and Exodus chapter 13 after the Passover that we've talked about a few weeks ago, right? When as part of God's plan to get Pharaoh to let his people go, right? He brings a plague upon the firstborn of Egypt, and the sign was blood over the doorpost that would tell God to pass over that house, right, and not take their firstborn. The actual Passover happens, and then God instills forever the feast of the Passover in his people. And he gives them instruction about what they ought to do, how they ought to eat it. And I'd encourage you to go back and read Exodus chapter 12 and 13, because it matters so much as we look at a text like this and thinking about what would have been going through God's people's minds as they prepared for the Passover. And one of the things that they're to do is that they're to eat unleavened bread for the entire week leading up to the Passover. And if you guys remember, they were instructed on the Passover to bake unleavened bread so that they could take it with them as God's Spirit comes in the night and leads them up out of Egypt. But in the feast, in the remembrance of the Passover, they're instructed for an entire week to eat nothing but unleavened bread. And the reason for that is right there on your screen. It's cleansing. It's preparing. They were to get all of the leaven out of the household over the course of that week. And over again in the Old Testament and even into the New, leaven is a picture of sin. Of the way that a little bit of leaven contaminates the whole batch. And so they're to purify their homes by eating only unleavened bread and to get all of the leaven out of the household. And so even as they're making their way into Jerusalem, there's commotion and there's teeming and they're talking about what's going on in their day and in their time. And could this be the time that they see the Messiah? And they're actively following God's instruction and purifying their homes and preparing for the Passover meal in their diets, in their households. And they're also celebrating God's deliverance in their lives. You see, that's really what the Passover feast was about. It was about remembering what God had done for his people. It was about remembering the way that he had delivered them up out of Egypt. And as they contemplated the way that God had miraculously delivered all of his people out of Egypt and out of the oppression of Pharaoh, it also calls to mind the ways that he had delivered them and protected them and provided for them in their own life. Isn't that, Isn't that still true for us as we look at the Bible and we think about the way that God has miraculously throughout history provided for his people? Are we reminded that he still does the same thing for us? Are we reminded that he is still good, that his character has not changed, that he's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow? Or do we just read it as a list of stories and we think, wow, that's wonderful? No, this is the God who we serve. And as we remember his faithfulness, as we remember his goodness, we're meant to put it in place in our own life and look at our own life and go, he's been faithful to me. He's been good to me. He's delivered me. And that very much would have been the conversation that they're having as they thought about God's deliverance. In fact, in Exodus chapter 13 and verse 14, God tells them exactly what all this feast is about, because towards the end of all of the instructions, it says that when your son asks you, what are all these things about? You're to say to him, this is a reminder of God's deliverance through his strong hand when he brought us up out of Egypt. And so they would have remembered those things. They would have thought about those things. It would have been the topic of discussion as the people that lived in Jerusalem and the millions coming from outside were making their way into the city. And so it's important that we understand that the account, the part that sticks in our mind where Jesus cleanses the temple, happens on the heels of all of those things, all of that excitement, all of that hope, all of these people traveling in to celebrate, to remember God's goodness. So the Passover there of the Jews was at hand, it says in verse 13, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem, and then in the temple he found those who were selling oxen and sheep and pigeons and money changers sitting there. So first, I wanted you to see Christ worshiped with God's people. But two, I want you to see Christ sets things straight. Amen. You see, this is, you know, we're told it just on paper in black and white that there's money changers and people selling animals. And we have to read it and we have to think about what this means. And sometimes this is a shortage for us, right? To be able to stop and picture God's word and to think about the richness that's in just a few sentences. But I want you to imagine. I want you to imagine walking with these millions of people and you come into the temple. That's the purpose that you're there for, after all. You're there for the Passover. And so you come to the temple. This was the main temple. There were other temples in other places, but this was the main temple that everybody came to. And upon entering the temple, there's people there that would inspect your sacrifice. Inspect your sacrifice. Because depending on the person that you got, some of them were only interested in saying that your sacrifice wasn't good enough and that you had to buy one of their animals. So you came all this way with an animal to sacrifice for the Passover to show your love for God and his deliverance. And then you find that even though it looked like a clean animal to you, even though it was the best of what you had, it goes before this inspector. And he's like, yeah, that's not going to do. You need to go over here and see my friend and he'll sell you a clean animal. Or you come in with your gift, there was a temple tax that was required. You come in with your gift in whatever currency of the land that you came from, only to find that the temple only accepts temple shekels. Whatever the coinage of the land that you came from is not good enough, and so you have to exchange it. That's what these money changers were doing. I don't know about you guys, but I've changed a lot of money in airports, and that's a ripoff, but this was a real ripoff. Sometimes like 30, 40, 50% undervalued the currency because they were the only ones that could exchange it for temple shekels. So you come to worship. You come thinking that you're doing this great thing that you've been commanded to honor God, only to find your money is not good enough. Your sacrifice isn't good enough. You find that the leaders, the people of God, the people that should know best what it is that God wants, have devised a system to fleece his people. And so Jesus sees the first thing that I want you guys to see when he sets things straight. His house was being desecrated. They had turned this place that was supposed to be meant for worship into a get-rich-quick scheme. It was recorded that some years before, there was a theft that happened in the temple. And historians indicate that something like $2 million in today's value was removed from the temple, and it made no impact on their treasury at all. That's how much corruption, that's how much thievery, I think is probably what God would call it, was going on in his house. But I want you to know that it's not just the religious leaders, it's not just the money changers, it's not just the people that were selling animals that are at fault here. God's people are at fault too. Because many of them would come unprepared. They would come having done nothing and rely on the money changers and rely on those that would sell sacrifices for offerings. You see, they took something that God meant to give them as a sign, meant to give them as a remembrance, meant to give them as something to talk about on the way in, and they turned it into an obligation, something that I can just go to a person and have them fulfill for me. And never have to give it any thought. Never have to remember God's goodness. Never have to remember the way that he has delivered his people. Never have to really sacrifice anything. So it's not just the religious leaders, the money changers, the priests that were at fault for desecrating his houses. Because you see, the second point I want you to see is that their sacrifices had become completely irrelevant. Sacrifice is only sacrifice when it costs us something. God is wholly unwilling to accept sacrifice that is just perfunctory, that is just something we do because we've been told to do it, or it's just the steps that we take. And that applies just as much then as it does today. He is not interested in the blood of animals. He is not interested in the burning of offerings. He is interested in a pure and contrite heart. Amen. And that he will not despise. And you see, the people were just as responsible for the desecration because they were willing to come into God's house and they were willing to take these holy steps that he had given them as remembrance, as worship in his temple. And they were willing to profane and pervert them into something that was just meant to be an appeasement. And that was never what God was interested in. The last thing I want you to see as he sets things straight is his house of prayer was for all the nations. You see, what we see over in Mark when we look at this story is that the place that they had set up was in the court of the Gentiles. The place that they had set up for the money changing and the selling of the animals was in the court of the Gentiles. It wasn't in the temple proper. It was in the place that only foreigners could come into. They could never get any further into the temple than this place. And instead of this being a place of worship for people who truly feared God, who weren't part of the Jewish people, instead, it was a bazaar, right? It was full of activity and haggling. Imagine you have to buy an animal. You're told your animal isn't good enough. And so there's a whole negotiation there. And then you're told you have to buy an animal. And you go to buy an animal. And you have to negotiate for that. And you go to convert your money only to be fleeced on the conversion rate and you have to negotiate for that. Can you imagine the commotion and the chaos and probably the anger and resentment that went on in a place like that? And yet this is the place where people who had heard God's name, who had heard of his goodness from lands far off and decided to fear him, this was the place where they could come and worship, and yet there was no place for them to worship at all. And all of these things is what drives Christ's indignation. His anger over the leaders desecrating his temple, his anger over his people being willing to offer sacrifices that are just totally meaningless, and his anger over the name and the character of God was meant to shine in all the nations, being impossible to do because the Gentiles didn't even have a place to worship because all of this activity was going on. So what does he do? This text is so instructive because it tells us he fashions a whip. And some people would use this to downplay Christ's righteous anger. I would use this to say it was purposeful. It wasn't the kind of anger that is so common to us where it's just a flash. Like that's the picture sometimes we get in our mind, is just Christ just turning over the tables in anger. No, he stopped and he fashioned a whip, and then he purposefully drove all of those people, all of the animals, all of the money changers out of the court of Gentiles. It was anger. This is what I said earlier. It matters. It matters how we see our God. It matters how we worship him. He was righteously angry over the perversion. And he had every reason to be, Vicky. You're right. You see, our God is both, our Savior is both the Lion and the Lamb. And when we worship one aspect at the expense of the other, we create a one-sided picture of who Christ is. It matters that he has no patience. He has no tolerance for people perverting his word, for calling people to a false sense of belief, to just a list of behaviors, to extorting his people. He has no patience for that. And ultimately, it's blasphemous against God to say that he would tolerate something like that. And so he sets things straight. So Christ worshiped with God's people. Christ sets things straight. Man, that's tough to say. Sets things straight. I don't know how Aaron would have done that with his lisp. Like I can barely do it. Christ sets things straight. And three, Christ fulfilled and spoke prophecy. I want you guys to take a look at what happens after he makes this whip and he drives them out of the temple. In verse 17, it says, his disciples remembered that it was written, zeal for your house will consume me. This is a reference back to Psalm 69:9. That psalm says, for zeal for your house has consumed me, and the reproaches of those who reproach you have fallen on me. You know what that means? That means that Christ could not stand the reproach that this was bringing on God by saying that God accepts these things. And that stirred him up with zeal for God's house. And so he says, this passage is about me. And then we get to look at the reaction of a few different people. First, I want to see the reaction of his disciples. That's actually the last thing that we see in the passage, but let's look at that first. Let's look at the reaction of his disciples. You see, it says in verse 22, and that's not the only prophecy in this passage, right? He also says, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. So he points them to Psalm 69. He also points them, and John is so good to give it to us right here in the text to say that he was talking about the temple of his own body. And what is his disciples' reaction? It says in verse 22, when therefore he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. You see, in the heart of the people who had started to follow him, in the heart of people who were really by you know, all accounts, like a week old in their faith at this point, seeing this reinforced for them who Christ was. And they held on to that, and they remembered it even for those 3 years. And so seeing him go to death on the cross and seeing him raised again in 3 days, they remembered that he said these things. And that solidified the belief in their heart. You see, I wonder why God sometimes doesn't seem real to us. It might be because we have an unrealistic picture of who God is. Not to say that we could have too high of a picture, but it's not real. It does not match his actual character. And yet seeing Christ like this began to solidify in the hearts of his disciples that he was indeed the Messiah that they believed him to be. So we see the reaction of his disciples. Let's look at the reaction of the Jews. That's the next thing that I want you to see. What's their reaction like? And again, it's helpful for us to picture in our mind what's going on, because we read it on paper, but we need to really just stop and think about this. So he has come into the temple. He has made a whip. He has overturned tables. He has driven out the money changers and all of the animals out of the court of the Gentiles. So this place that was full of commotion, full of conflict, is now empty because of Christ's actions. And yet, what is the reaction of the Jews? They say, what sign? What sign do you give us for having done these things? Translated, that question is, what authority do you have? How can you prove to us that you can come into this place and do this thing? What sign do you give us for this action? How might we believe that you really have the authority to come in here and drive everybody out in such a fashion? Rather than taking the action as the sign itself, because this was no easy thing. I don't know that anybody except God in the flesh could have come into the temple with this kind of authority and this kind of power and moved this many people out of the place that they were in. And yet their first reaction is, well, what sign do you give us to prove that you really can do this? How about the proof that I just did it? How about the proof? I mean, it really is such a picture of their unbelief. They want to know, what else can you do? What other miracles can you demonstrate to us that will prove that you have this kind of authority? Rather than accepting the judgment on their behavior, rather than accepting the fact that they are the ones who have perverted God's temple, instead they ask for a sign. And Jesus, lastly in this section, I want you to see the response of Jesus, because he gives them a sign. What sign do you show us for doing these things? And Jesus answered them. This is his response to their question about what signs he gives them. And he says, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. And the Jews are still not understanding. They're still looking for some sort of evidence. They're still looking for something that they can use as proof. And they say, it's taken us 46 years to build this temple, and you will raise it up in 3 days. But you know what Jesus was saying? I love John. He tells us right in the text, he was talking about He was talking about his body. He was talking about his crucifixion. He was talking about his resurrection. And we see that right there in the text. But can I tell you what he was also talking about? He was talking about the place that God dwelt. The place where God is worshipped. In those 3 days, it would go from being a temple to being the heart of the Christ follower. That becomes the place that God is worshipped. That becomes the place where his spirit dwells. It's not only about the physical destruction of the temple. It's not only about Christ's body as a representation of the temple being destroyed and raised again in 3 days. It's also about transferring the place of worship from this place that can be perverted. Well, I guess the place that we worship could also be perverted. From this place that could be corrupted. Well, I guess the place where the Holy Spirit dwells now can also be corrupted. To this place that could be focused on all of the wrong things when it's supposed to be focused on the worship of God. And yet, I guess the place that he dwells now can be focused on all the wrong things instead of on the worship of God. And yet, in this moment, God is instilling a change from a place where people went to do a bunch of behaviors that were religious to being in the hearts of the people who follow him. Which makes the rest of this passage that much more important, that much more relevant for us today, that much more critical for us to understand. And that's where I want to spend the rest of our time. Verse 23 says, "Now when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover feast, many believed in his name when they saw the signs that he was doing. But Jesus, on his part, did not entrust himself to them because he knew all people and he needed no one to bear witness about man, for he himself knew what was in man." The last thing I want you to see is Christ did not entrust himself to them. You see, what the Bible tells us is that there were people that were seeing all of these things. They were seeing the way that he confronted the religious leaders. They were seeing the way that he taught with authority. They were seeing the way that he was leading his disciples. And they believed in his name. And yet Christ, he knows what's in the heart of man. He knows whether all throughout his ministry, whether they're just believing because of the signs and the miracles that they're seeing. He knows whether they're just believing because of what they see with their eyes, or he knows whether they're believing because of what is sincerely in their heart. Amen. And that matters to Christ. We know it matters because we see it in his response. He didn't entrust himself to them because he knew what was in their heart. That's the first thing that I want you to see. He knows the nature of man. If you're sitting in this place and you're wondering how do I trust the Savior? How do I follow this God who at both in both hands, right, loves unconditionally, loves his people so much that he would send his only son, that he would send himself in the flesh to die as a sacrifice, and yet could be this angry, could be this upset by unrighteousness? Can he love me? Can I tell you that he knows the nature of man? He is intimately familiar with the nature of man. He created us in his own image for his purposes, and he knows what's in our heart. And so it matters what's in our heart. It matters what's in our heart because God knows it.
He can see it. The things that nobody else can see, he knows and he sees. And it makes me wonder. It makes me wonder as we look at this picture of his anger and his indignation at the money changers in the temple and the people selling offerings. It makes me wonder when he looks at my heart, is that how he also feels? Is that how he also feels when he looks at what I see and what I do and what I say and the things that I think about? He knows the nature of man. But he insists that a man should know what he is doing. That's the second point that I want you to see. You see, when we make a choice to follow Christ, it's got to be sincere. Because he knows what's in our heart. That doesn't mean that everything is perfect. That doesn't mean that we cease to sin. It does mean that our sin nature is changed. It does mean that we're rescued from death and into life. It does mean when we believe on Christ that we now have a new kingdom, a new nature, a new inheritance, that we have a choice where before we were just slaves to sin. So there's hope. But I want you to know, he wants us to know what it is that we believe. He wants us to know the cost of discipleship when we make that choice to follow him. We should recognize that the temple that's our hearts does need to be purged. It does need to be removed of hypocrisy and of idols. It does need to be cleansed. And we should be willing to do that. If we're going to make a choice to follow Christ, we should be willing to be cleansed by him. And you see him weighing these people that are saying, we want to believe in your name, and yet he's going, do you really know what it's going to cost you to believe in my name? Do you know that it's going to cost you the things that you hold on to, the sins that you cling to, the things that you don't want to let go, and yet that he desires to relieve you of? Do you know that it's going to cost you those things that you at least temporarily derive joy and pleasure from? It's going to cost you that. Do you know that it's going to cost you friends and family to be a person who is following Christ as Lord and not anybody else? It will cost you relationships. Do you know that it's going to cost you? For some of these people that the Bible says were believing in his name in this moment, for some of them, just a couple of years later, it's going to cost them their life. And he can see their hearts and he wants to know that they're counting the cost. And yet, having counted the cost to take up your cross and follow him daily, that they're still willing to do it. And that's the same question that he has for us. Maybe you thought, all I have to do to follow Christ is say a prayer, go under some water. Maybe you thought that it was an easy thing to do because your parents and your grandparents went here. Maybe you thought, like the people who were going to the temple for sacrifice, that all I have to do is show up on Sunday morning and sing a few songs and put a few dollars in the plate, and maybe that'll be good enough. But it's not, because Christ knows our heart and he wants to be Lord of your heart. And that is the only option that he will accept. Because what comes with that is beautiful. The freedom that we see in the gospel, this new life, this freedom from sin, it only happens when we're willing to let him be Lord of everything and to drive out the wicked places in us, because the temple that he wants to dwell in is the temple of our hearts, and he wants to cleanse it. Amen. so that it would be a wonderful dwelling place for His Holy Spirit. So we got to ask ourselves, what are the things in my life, even if I'm professed to be following Christ, that would create this indignation that we see, that causes them to fashion this whip and turn over these tables? Is it my internet searches? Is it my Facebook messages, response, posts? Is it my endless Instagram scroll? These are all things I've heard of. I'm not familiar with any of them myself, but I think some of you guys are, right? Is it what I watch on TV? Is it how I talk to my friends? Is it what I'm willing to accept at work that is so much less than the degree of excellence and the degree of integrity that God calls us to? Is it my faithfulness to my spouse in thought or in deed? Is it my unfaithfulness to my future spouse, for some of our younger people in the room? Every one of those things He can see with perfect clarity. You aren't hiding anything from Him, and He wants to cleanse you of it, because that's the place where we find healing. That's the place where we find the joy that we saw in the wedding feast. You see, I told you that these things are next to each other for a reason, but that's the picture, is that His temple, after this action, is restored to a place where God can be worshipped, where there's joy and excitement again. He wants us to count the cost of discipleship. And as the band comes, take a look at our last point here, because you see, there is this emotional commitment that the people are making in this story in the moment, right? They're seeing the signs, and they're responding, and they're wanting to believe. And if you're a follower of Christ, you can relate to that. Like, there was a moment in your life where you could so clearly feel the moving of the Holy Spirit that tells you that this, exactly what the Bible says, it confirms for us these things that we ought to believe. And for many of us, that does. It stirs up emotion within us. It's why we can look back on that day and we can remember it so clearly, because of all the things that go along with that and how we were feeling. But at some point, we have to move beyond emotion, and we have to move to commitment and self-surrender. Amen. Do you want to know why I firmly believe this picture of Christ's indignation is also such a picture of the way that He would react to the church today? It's because so many of our churches are filled with emotion and nothing else. So many of them are designed to manipulate people's emotions in the moment and to elicit a response, but they never force us to commit and to sacrifice and to follow Christ in the way that He asks us to follow Him, where we deny ourselves and where we take up our cross and where we are willing and we've counted the cost of discipleship and everything is on the line. And my only option is to obey. That's the kind of followers that Christ is looking for. That's the kind of people that for hundreds of years have shaken up this country over and over again. When revival stirs up, it is because there are people who are sold out. They have moved beyond emotional attachment, and they are committed to self-sacrifice for Christ. And so I ask you, is that you? I think as far as responses go, this is an easy one. It might not be easy to deal with the topic, but the answer is really straightforward. As we take a moment to pray, as we take a moment to respond to God, the question that you have to ask yourself is, if I've professed myself to be a Christ follower, would Jesus look at the condition of my life and say that I've counted the cost? That I'm willing to pick up my cross, that I'm willing to die to myself, that anything that gets in the way of me following him is on the line and ready to be chopped should he say the word? Or am I holding on to? Am I holding on to things? Am I holding on to things that keep me from experiencing the joy and the life and the goodness of his kingdom? Am I holding on to things that keep me from experiencing the victory in my friends and loved ones? I wonder why nobody wants to hear the gospel from me. Nobody wants to believe. Maybe it's the things that I'm holding on to in my life that make me not such a great witness. So we have to ask ourselves that. I'm going to give you a moment to reflect. But if you're in this place and you don't know Christ, I know that this seems like a strong word, but can I tell you that even in this, God is good. He loves you. He wants to free you from the place that you find yourself, and he has given his son to live a perfect and sinless life and yet to be put to death on a cross, not because of his unrighteousness, but because of ours. In fact, if he was put to death for anything, it was because of his righteousness that people hated him and wanted to crucify him. But God did that for us, for you, knowing exactly the condition of your heart, and yet he calls you to come to him. He calls you to lay down the things that you would cling to and instead take up the joy and the hope that he gives. And no better thing could happen today than that somebody would count the cost and say, you know what? Hearing all of this, hearing even the character of this Christ, who not just is a humble and meek servant, but is also a strong, righteous Lord, who is both the Lion and the Lamb. Yes, counting the cost, I want to follow him. And if you want to make that choice today, I'm going to be here to receive you. If there's a commitment that you need to make, I will be right here to pray with you. But the work that happens in this moment, it happens right in your seat. It happens right there with you taking the time to talk to God. So God has spoken, church. Let's take the time to respond. Let me pray. God, we thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you for its goodness, Lord, and the way that it stands the test of time, Lord, and the way that it doesn't just go to conversations that are easy, Lord, but that you try to take us down that road that is narrow. Lord, the one that few find, and yet you've shown us right where it is, Lord, and you've revealed yourself to us, Lord, and you have called us to obedience. So would you lead us in this moment, Lord? Convict us. Show us the things that we are clinging to, Lord, that they conflict with your glory. Lord, where you can't dwell in the same place as those things. And God, would you help us to rid our lives of them, Lord, and run to you and to count the cost and decide that you are worth it, Lord. And if there's somebody in this place who has never believed on you and needs that hope, God, I pray that you would reveal yourself to them. Lord, that through your Holy Spirit you would cause them to believe. And Lord, would they step out of that aisle, Lord, having trusted you, and Lord, would they want to share it with this whole place, Lord, that we might rejoice with the angels of heaven. Lord, we love you and we thank you and we praise you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Pray, church. The Lord has spoken.